You know, when holidays come, all kinds of, we see people we hadn't seen in a while. They come through, we enjoy them, and we say, "Oh, by the way, I love you anyway." And we just enjoy, that was supposed to be funny, but we hang out with family. And so you never know who's going to be here on a holiday Sunday. Sometimes it's a great number of folks we hadn't met yet. Sometimes it's some folks we hadn't seen in a while. But I am glad you are here. Now, my wife, I ask you to keep us in prayer. When she's not setting up here with me, she's normally always up in one of the children's churches. But the last couple of weeks, you know, we have had her mom with us in our house. And she ran Agnes back to Panama City, Florida on Thursday. And no sooner than reaching Panama City, she got a call from her other mother and in Baton Rouge and medical event going on there. So she jumped over to Baton Rouge, and that's where she's at right now. And hope that she'll be on her way back sometime Monday. So we're just a little scattered out. Anybody else that way? Here and there, families everywhere. You know, today's message, living by faith. If you want to open your Bible to Hebrews 11, a few select verses there, we're going to start this chapter. America would be a far greater country to come back to the principles of faith, that there is one God that we are under, one nation under God. Even that, even though that is not saving faith, that is great revelation that exalts a nation. And happy birthday, America. We love our country, and we want God's blessing on our nation. You know, living by faith, Hebrews 11, no words are packed with meaning more foundational to the Christian experience than faith and grace. These two words, they are the mega words. Ephesians 2 says this, "For by grace ye are saved through faith." It is God's grace, His gift to us, His goodness for us. Its salvation is God's grace, but our faith is what is required. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So even the central doctrine of man being redeemed and having eternal life and avoiding eternal destruction, that doctrine of salvation hinges on man's faith, God's grace. What an important word. So as we look at this chapter, I want us to just kind of get our beak wet this morning, and I don't want to saturate us or immerse us to where we're drowning with information, but I just want to whet our appetite for a renewal, a quickening of our faith. You know, living by faith expects something. It expects that God's going to show up in each set of circumstances that I'm going through. So that's exciting. That we would live expecting, looking for, anticipating God to show up. Living by faith also resists the pull of this world while constantly leaning into Jesus. It's an active, it's living by faith is anything but a static dogma that we attach our mental assent to many years ago. Living by faith is actively resisting the pull of the world while leaning into Jesus for power to do so. You know, living by faith. We have so many examples, a great cloud of witnesses in this chapter that we are going to peer into their lives. But living by faith does this, I assure you. It believes God's promises while we wrestle through the questions we still have. So faith is just this enormous anchor that doesn't close its eyes to problems in the world or problems or contradictions in my mind, but we believe God while we wrestle through the problems. So with that being said, I'd like to now read our text this morning, chapter 11, verse 1. The Bible says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good testimony. And by faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible." Father, as we right now just draw a circle around our soul, around our heart, we would ask that the Spirit would quicken, make alive, bring your word to application, that we would better walk out of here in a few moments living by faith and realize that's an active experience with you, anything but dull. In Jesus' name we ask it, amen. So faith is, in verse number 1, described. And I want you to look back at that verse, if you would. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You know, that I find that poetic, but I find it a bit difficult. And I don't know if I'm the only one that way, but I find this particular translation of verse 1 very poetic, and I love it, but boy, it's a little obscure. It slips past me without careful thought. So I look at verse number 1, and I think I can see some things that are very clear. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. You know, faith treats the things hoped for as substantive, as factual. Faith treats those things we are hoping for, and that hope is always tied to what God has said. Faith treats the promises of God as substantive, factual. The evidence of things not seen in verse number 1. Faith is confident of the unseen realm. Faith is confident of those future promises. So I like to just understand verse 1 to be a little more obtainable, that it deals with confidence in God's words. We treat them factually. We're confident of the things we are expectant of in the future, the promises of God. Now, to illustrate that, to illustrate verse number 1, just back up to the previous chapter. And look at verse 37 and verse 38, because you have a great example of treating God's words as factual and modifying behavior based on it, living by faith based on the certainty of an unseen promise. So here we go. Look at verse number 37. "For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry." Jesus is coming. "Now, today, the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back from that life of faith, that interactive, abiding, drawing, constant strength, leaning into Jesus through all circumstances. If anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him," or that will not please me, of course. So see, what we see in verse 37, Jesus is coming, and we can live our life with confidence. So let's go out and live accordingly. We know he's coming, so let's live by faith. Now, right here, I'd like to just maybe coin a definition that I think in this context, in chapter 11, going forward in this mini-series, that this definition will serve us well. Faith is believing what God has said and acting on it. Jesus is coming, so I must live by faith. With certainty, that promise is true. Faith is believing what God has said, but acting here and now on it. You know, sometimes this word faith is misapplied in our lives, but maybe even in those outside church. When we drift off of what biblical faith is, and there's a little bit of a man-made assertion about faith. So if we can show that definition of faith, if we have it, faith is believing what God has said while acting on it. And let me give you man's assertion about faith. Sometimes people say faith is believing whatever I can imagine and expecting it. Whatever I can imagine and expecting it. And this, if we're not careful, will devolve into a very self-centered type of faith. Whatever I can imagine when it comes to wealth, and I can expect it. Faith is believing whatever I can imagine when it comes to influence and power, and then I will expect it. And on it goes. Faith is believing whatever I can imagine for my personal healing or for a relationship. And I believe that biblical faith, as we look at it in Hebrews 11, living by faith will affect every single area of our life. Yes, it will affect our finances. Yes, it can affect our health. It will affect our health. It will affect every area of our life. But here's the truth. Biblical faith will always first reference itself to what God has said and what is God's will. Those are the two benchmarks for biblical faith. First, what has God said? What is His promise on the matter? And what is His will in my life? And those are the first hinge pins. And then all the other areas of life are affected according to the will of God and according to the promises of God. So, you know, I like to just remind and say it again. Faith is believing what God has said and then acting on it. And I think of this story that came out of Australia many years ago. A fellow was wandering around and got lost in the outback. And he stumbled upon a shed that was over in the brush. And no one around for many miles, and he was very famished and thirsty. And he got into that shed, and there, as he opened the door in the far corner of the shed, there was one of those hand pumps, and he was just like, oh, yeah. What? And he goes over to the pump, and he works that thing for a few minutes, and it is dry as a bone. It's just not producing. And in discouragement, he just leaned back into the corner, and he's seriously becoming into an emerging crisis of health. And as he leaned back into the corner on the opposite side of the room that he had just walked in on, there was a jug sitting there, and it had some kind of note on it. And he went over and he picked that jug. It was a jug of water. And that note said these words, "Pour all the contents of this jug down the well to prime the pump. Then help yourself to all the water you want. P.S., please fill up the jug for the next person." Well, similarly, faith is believing what God has said to us and then acting on it. And as the story is told from Australia, the man wrote, "P.S., it really works." And he put the jug back on the other side of the room again. So, you know, faith is believing what God has said and acting on it. And I just wondered this morning, what areas of our life has God already said things to us? And it's time for us to act on that. You see, Disobedience this morning can turn to a step of faith. It's a beautiful thing. That's what revival is. It was when God's people take a fresh step. So where God has already spoken, where God has already promised, where God has already touched your heart to do this or don't do that, where God has already spoken and we act on it, you know what you're doing, my friend? You and I, we are living by faith. And there's no greater way to discover who God is and all of his affections and love and see a constant flow of grace, strength, and dynamic, life-changing items that come from us to other people around us. It's called the river of living water. There's no greater way to experience that than the areas God has been touching for a while. He's spoken. But we go ahead and respond, and we act on it. Sometimes we don't always know exactly the action we're supposed to take. Sometimes it's a series of steps. But that's what the song is about, living by faith. You know, we, one day at a time, we take the step that God makes obvious to us. Now, I must go on. Faith is believing what God has said while acting on it. But faith also obtains something for us. In verse number 2, it says that for by faith, the elders obtained a good testimony. And the elders referred to, I think, would talk about the 17 people mentioned in chapter 2. And then there are descriptive circumstances towards the end of the chapter that enumerate another couple dozen more people. So we're talking about a great cloud of witnesses in chapter 11. The elders, how did they get a good testimony with God? It was through faith. How did they get a good witness before men? It was through faith. So this good testimony is in the eyes of God. And I would ask you this morning, do you have a good testimony? What qualifies a good testimony with God? Is, are we hearing his words and are we acting on them? You know, I like what my dad taught me growing up. And I think most dads would press this on their kids at some point, but dad was one, don't put off till tomorrow what you can actually do today. And he taught me to keep a reference to sunset, and things around our house were kind of visual. My chores were visual. And when it got dark, it got harder to do those outside tasks. And he was like, you know, you come home from school and you've got play, of course, but you've got time to get things done till it's dark. And don't put off a step that God has been nudging you to take. That's how we have a good testimony. As we say, Lord, I just humbly come today, and I realize there's an area of my life you've been speaking, and now I'm just stepping towards you in this area. Would you continue to speak? Because I really don't know how to take another step. That's beautiful. That's living by faith. And think about some of these people in chapter 11. Abraham, how literal that was. Just leave town, Abraham. And he had to take the first step. Noah, just start cutting some trees. And he would have to take that first step. Well, faith also obtains a good testimony for us, but faith understands some things. Now, I'd like you to look at verse 3 again, because this morning we're just launching what it means to live by faith, and I'm so excited about the portraits of faith we'll be looking at. People's lives, little snapshots of what another brother or sister's wrestling with the promises of God while believing God. They lived it out for us. They're not different from us in that way. I look forward to us looking at those portraits of faith. But this is a little bit more foundational message. You know, faith will cause us to just, we have to understand some things, accept some things. Look at verse 3. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. Now, this next phrase is super profound. Written 2,000 years ago, before there ever was a theory penned in books called evolution. Look at it. The things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. That's a direct connection to evolutionary theory. That visible things did not give rise to all that we today have. In the beginning was the cosmos, or in the beginning was the Creator. Through faith we understand that faith believes God while we wrestle with our questions. I don't know if there's a struggle today in the room about believing God created the entire existence of the universe with his word. I would not know if a heart today struggles with that. But by faith we understand the universe was created by the word of God, and by faith we understand nothing visible is the causative agent of all other things. You know, here's some thoughts for us. The telescopes, they reveal vast expanses of space and matter. That's just incredible distances in between. Large expanse of space, and then you come to some planet or some star. And then there's telescopes show us incalculable forces, forces that are out of this world. They're so powerful in other galaxies. And all of that's out there. We can see it. And it tells us something. God is bigger than we thought. You know, I am told today that God made the world. And the world, the earth, is 25,000 miles in circumference. It weighs estimated weight of 6 septillion tons. And yet, that globe, it hangs in space. It is observed now with our satellites. It hangs in space on nothing, as Isaiah the prophet said. It spins on its axis at 1,000 miles per hour. And that globe, it careens it through space on a 580 million mile orbit around the sun. And it's moving through space at 60,000 plus miles per hour to make that circuit in 1 year. And while you and I go through a day on Earth, my hair, some days, oh yeah, you're going there, aren't you? On some days, my hair doesn't even blow out of position. And yet it's spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, and it's careening through space at 60,000 miles per hour. And we know all of this. It is time to right-size God in our hearts. God is bigger than we ever thought. He's more powerful than we ever thought. By faith, we understand the universe was created by the word of God. He is the causative agent, not anything on the planet or off the planet. It was God. Microscopes. Now we go from the grand to the minute. Microscopes reveal some amazing things as we peer through the 1,000th power and the 10,000th power. Microscopes reveal volumes of hidden information at the cellular level, genetic coding, strands of information that this means that this cell will move in that direction, and this means that the cell will grow in that direction. How did that information get arranged and encoded? I want to tell you, my friends, not only is God great on the grand scale, but he is great with details. And you know another thing he is great with? Who am I that he is mindful of me, and how precious is his thoughts toward me? He thinks of me. He is awesome in relationship. So as we begin this chapter of living by faith, we're seeing people that were in a vibrant living relationship. They had to take God at his word and take the step, act on his word by a step of obedience. And their life shook the world around them. They made a difference. They had a great testimony with God, and they had a great witness with man. And I want that. I want that. So faith understands that the worlds were framed by the word of God. You know, we have a couple options this morning. And let me just finish this point up, and we'll be closing the service here in just a few moments. But don't get your hopes up. Give me 10 minutes. We have a couple options. The first, how did life originate? Here's option number one. The first introduction of life was a fragile blob of protoplasm that came together in response to an electrical discharge over a primeval ocean. Thank you, Carl Sagan. In other words, a lightning bolt blasted a primeval soup and out popped clan stew. Non-living matter has been there all along, and some arrangement of electrical current and chemicals called forth life. Non-living matters became alive. Or the other option is the Creator called forth the proportions and variations of chemicals and essential elements, and he animated them and brought them to life. You see, both these take faith, don't they? Neither one. We weren't there, were we, at the origins? There's only two ideas, the cosmos versus the Creator. Something has always existed, or someone has always existed, but both of these call for faith. Now I want to tell you a story about a neighbor I had in Sri Lanka. I had a retired lawyer that was a devout Buddhist as a neighbor. And I talked with him on many, many occasions. He never did become a Christian. Well, at least while I was there. He said that he, and I'm being very exact with his representation, he was an atheist and a rationalist, and that it did not make sense to believe in God. And I disagreed with him, and he could take that. We would have nice little debates. And I learned something, that no matter what reason or evidence I brought to the table, when the human heart says, I don't want to submit to a creator, there'll always be another excuse. So what do we need to pray for? We need to pray that the conviction of God will come upon people's hearts. We present them with truth and evidence, but without God's conviction, there'll be no salvation. In one conversation with Mr. Tilakaratne, I asked him, where did you come from? Now, this is the only time that I could ever recall in the series of I've asked these questions to many people, and he answered this way, I'm being very accurate. He said he came from monkeys. And I said, where did the monkeys come from? And he gave an answer, and we worked our way every time. He gave me, well, it came from this, it came from that. He was working right through the textbook evolutionary line. And we got back to some dust and stuff in space, some particles and stuff out there in space. And we worked all the way back to stardust, and I asked him, where did the stardust come from? And he said, here's what he said, quote, Charles, you must realize that some things have just always been. Well, he has faith, but his faith is in something. You see, he believed in the beginning was the cosmos. He believed something has always existed, but the Bible says someone has always existed. And here's the good news, my brother, that someone is Jesus Christ, and the Father and the Spirit, and that he made us, and that he loves us, and we can know him, and that is such good news. You know, the beauty of this truth that we're talking about, in the beginning, God created. That God framed the worlds with his word, and that matter did not give rise to all things we see, but it was arranged. It was put there first by the Creator, but then arranged by him. This denounces atheism. In the beginning, God created. It refutes pantheism. Because God is transcendent from creation. In the beginning, God created. It refutes polytheism. Because God is a one unified God, and he created all. It refutes materialism, because matter is subordinate to God. In the beginning, God created, refutes humanism, because man is not in control. Wow. And yes, in the beginning, God created, refutes evolution, because it is God's word that established the species, the kinds of animals, the kinds of plants, and set the limits on their variations within those kinds. All of those systems I just went through, humanism, materialism, polytheism, all of these are just different expressions of unbelief. Verse 3 says, through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. Aren't you glad when it's okay to be real transparent and honest? Because God has said, the only way you can know for certain that I have created all things and created you and loved you and willing to redeem you and walk with you in relationship with you, it's going to be by faith. The other side is not quite as honest, but it takes a lot more faith to believe their side than it does that there is in the beginning God. Well, now I want us to look at verse 6, the final point of our message today. You know, we are not of those who draw back from living by faith. The just shall live by faith. And let it be. Let's live that way in a dynamic interaction with our Creator through His Spirit based on the blood of His Son. Let's live by faith. Look at verse number 6. Verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Do you know that this thrills my heart, that the Father says it is okay to seek, to expect, to anticipate, to enjoy his rewards. He says, if you diligently seek me, I will reward. You know, this is a beautiful verse, one of my most favorite in all of Scripture. It is possible to please God. That should wake in all of our hearts. That should put a spark in our step that I can please God. What would please him? God has asked us to believe two things. Oh, yes, there are many actions that will flow out of that belief system. But he asks us first and foremost to anchor our faith to two foundational beliefs. He exists, and he rewards those who diligently seek him. It is time again for America to put this to the test. It is time again for God's people to wake up and to say, you know what? I need his reward upon me, and I must ask, seek, and knock and pursue his blessing. I want it. What God has revealed to me already, I will take that step of obedience. I will not forebode any longer. That is living by faith, and that will revive a Christian, and that will revive a church. And that will heal a nation. Well, I'd ask you this question. When was the last time the truth of God's rewarding you? Think about that. He is ready to reward you. When was the last time the truth of God's reward changed your behavior? That's living by faith. Abraham did that. Sarah did that. Rahab did that. Gideon did that. When was the last time of God rewarding you changed your behavior? I think it's time to start seeking his reward. We can please him. Would you please stand together with me as we close our service in a time of prayer? Living by faith. I hope you'll come back every week to this series. And let's just build in all these portraits and see the examples of men and women of God who heard God's word and they took steps of obedience. But what's the Spirit saying to you this morning? Why don't we bow our heads? Today, if God's drawing you and you feel him speaking into your heart, I want you to come. Find your spot at the front here. Respond to our Father. Church family, what step of faith is he prompting you to take? What area has he already talked to you about? Oh Lord, I want to live by faith. I don't want to draw back, but to live by faith means we're responding, we're interacting. If you're here today and unsure that Jesus Christ is your Savior, we want you to be sure. Would you come? We will make sure we have a lady or a man to take and counsel you on that subject. Maybe you realize it's time to renew my surrender. I've not been living by faith. I've been struggling with being grateful. I've been resisting the brokenness God is calling me to. And I'm not living the surrendered life. Oh, would you come this morning and find a spot of renewal? Come just as you are, but leave with his reward upon you. Anyone else? Our Father, we believe that you are a rewarder. We believe it deep to our being. But the Bible tells us you reward those who diligently seek you. Our Father, we know Jesus is coming again. We anchor our life to that. We look to the heavens and expect that. Would you please help me diligently obey everything you're revealing to me? Father, would you motivate me to diligently seek you for my next step? We are looking to you to show up each day. We want to live by faith, believing your promises and acting on them. Help us to believe God, act on his promises, and be rewarded. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a happy 4th of July. God bless you. Have a great day.